been a miracle. I'm living proof. 'Cause I was dead in the spiritual, but I walked out the tomb. I've been raised to life by the power of Christ. That amazing grace has made me brand new. So if you're looking for the only brother, he's not here. I heard that resurrection calling for me loud and clear. Now I'm wide awake. Check that empty grave. If you're looking, looking for the old me, he's not here. No, he's not here. Listen. It's unbelievable, this love I found. It forgave a criminal and tore the prison down. I moved past the past. I'm free at last. Hallelujah, nothing's holding me down. So if you're looking for the only brother, he's not here. I heard that resurrection calling for me loud and clear. Now I'm wide awake. Check that empty grave. If you're looking, looking. Left the tomb and took me with him. He's not here. Brought my soul from grave to glory. I'm alive like Sunday morning. He's not here. No.
Well, good morning, First Baptist Church. Hey, good morning. I heard y'all. I always hear you. You guys got your Wheaties and your coffee this morning. You're ready to go. Isn't it a great day to be in God's house, to worship Him in spirit and in truth? Thank you for all of you who prayed for myself and Jay and Ann and our families as we went to the minister's family retreat this weekend. And got to hear some great messages to be filled back up, to be renewed. It was really powerful, and it was excited. The guest speaker there was my childhood pastor that I had growing up, and so it was great to reminisce and see people. and be reminded that our God is powerful, He is strong, and that He can guide our footsteps. Amen. So that's when, as we sing, as we praise this morning, I want you to remember how great your God is, how awesome He is, and that with Him, anything can be accomplished. Whatever He has for your life, He will accomplish in you, for He promised that He would do that until the day of Christ Jesus. Would you stand as we're going to begin with our verse this morning from Matthew 16, verses 13 through 20. And it says, "Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea and Philippi, He asked His disciples, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is?' And they said, 'Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets.' He said to them, 'But who do you say that I am?' Simon Peter replied, 'You are the Christ, the Son of the living God.' And Jesus answered him, 'Blessed are you, Simon of Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but My Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build My church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth, you shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.' Then He strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that He was the Christ." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This morning we have a new song to teach you. It is exactly what that verse was just talking about, that the church, we need to rise and rise up not in a way of confrontation, but in a way of love to share with others the truth and the freedom of the gospel. So as you learn this new hymn this morning, be mindful of these words as we sing, "O Church, Arise." Your armor on, hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we stand against the devil's lies. An army bold whose battle reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor. And with a sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure, and Christ will have the price for which He died, an inheritance of nations. As the Son of God is stricken, and then see His foes right crushed beneath His feet. For the conqueror has risen, and as the storm is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, His victory march continues all the day. Every eye and heart shall see Him. So speak. every stride, giving grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. And as we hold, see it light the way, retelling triumphs of His grace, we hear the calls and hunger for the day when with Christ we stand in glory. As saints of old, still light the way, retelling triumphs of His grace. For we hear the calls and hunger for the day when with Christ we stand in glory. Grace is unmeasurable this morning. Grace unmeasured, vast and free, knew me from eternity. Called me out before my birth to bring Your glory on this earth. Grace amazing, pure, Amen. You may be seated this morning as we move into our time of prayer. The quietness of the hour, and I'm going to invite Rinaldin to come up to lead us in our prayer this morning as we bow our heads and close our eyes in reverence to him.
Let's all bow our heads. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for the people that are here. I thank you just for who you are and what you've done on the cross for us, Lord. I'd like to pray for the students that are going back to school. I pray for the parents first, that they're giving their kids, they're showing their kids a Christian heritage, that they're leading them to Christ because they're with them every day. Lord, and I thank you for those faithful parents who argue with them, who try and get them up in the morning. Lord, I thank you for their willingness to have them here. Lord, I also pray for the choices of the students, that you would just guide them and help them to realize that you're the truth. You're our Lord and Savior. I pray that you would give them direction, and let them know that you care, Lord. They have struggles, and just help them to lean upon you. Lord, I also pray that you hold them accountable. I pray that their highest priority is to please you, Lord. I pray that they would just come to know your truths, whether it's at home reading their Bible, or whether it's coming to Sunday school, Wednesday night. Lord, I thank you just for you touching their hearts. And just, Lord, I ask that whatever teachings that they receive, that they apply them in their lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to First Baptist Church, and trust that you are enjoying your summer because it gets back quickly. And if you have your Bibles with you, please, I'd ask that you take your Bible and turn to the fifth chapter of Galatians, series of messages I'm preaching during this month on being free in Christ, and I'm focused today on freedom in Christ. And so if you have your Bibles open to the fifth chapter, I'd ask that you would stand in honor of God's word as we read verse 1. Galatians, the fifth chapter, verse 1. For it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. Father, your generation has assembled, a generation that is live and well today. And may the generations come behind us, understanding that your word is truth, sharper than a two-edged sword. And even if the grass withers and the flowers fade, that God, your word stands forever and ever. I'd ask your blessings on those who have assembled here today, those who are viewing and listening, that your spirit would speak to all of us. In the name of Jesus, we ask these things. Amen. Thank you for standing in honor of God's word this morning. Clearly, according to the New Testament, Jesus provided two different kinds of freedom. Freedom from and a freedom for. Today, we have been set free in Christ. And so I want to illustrate, examine, hopefully to enlighten and then instruct these differences in the two terms that are used. In Luke, the 13th chapter, we see an example of Jesus saving someone from something. Jesus is teaching in the synagogue when he confronts a woman who has been crippled for 18 years. He tells her, "Woman, you have been set free from your infirmity." That is in verse 12 of chapter 13 of Luke's gospel. At that point, this woman stands up straight and she walks away, liberated, free from the pain. And if we live long enough in life, there are going to be some pains. Some of those pains are going to be emotional. Some of those pains are going to be physical, rather than it be arthritic pain or damage to the human body. And pain is a way that our body is made to tell us that something is not functioning just exactly right. I want to encourage every adult that is here today, when you have those pains, sometimes it's temporary. One day you wake up, your knee hurts. The next day you wake up, it's not your knee anymore, it's the ankle on the other leg that hurts. And we understand that. Sometimes it is arthritic pain. Last evening, I was in a conversation with my fourth grade teacher in elementary school. And I asked her, "How is your spirits and your health?" And she said she's doing great, except for the arthritic problems. But I'm still mobile. So we got to keep moving. But the pain is there. Sometimes we carry emotional pain. Emotional pain is something we'd like to be set free of, find some kind of a remedy to that which we carry week in, week out, day in, day out. It may keep us awake at night, and it may keep us from enjoying the freedom that God has given us in Christ. That is one kind of freedom. Jesus gives freedom from. You'll find in this story of Luke's gospel, Jesus sets free from her physical infirmity. But on other occasions, he set people free from the bondage of sin or the power of Satan, from the burden and guilt and the fear that they carry in their lives. We are fearful for what the future may hold, or the destiny of our individual life or that of our families. We're concerned. We carry that burden with us. There are times when we carry the burden of the guilt that we have in our lives. And that carries with us oftentimes a lifetime. Not intended to, but because of our makeup and because of the way God has literally put us together and because the evil one seems to like to bring something up. It may have taken place many, many years ago. The freedom Christ gives is the freedom from some things. Toward the end of the 8th chapter of John's gospel, Jesus refers to another kind of freedom. He writes, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." There's been a great study done over the centuries of what is truth. And I'm not here today to argue truth or go through the philosophers of a lifetime of world existence of educated people trying to determine what truth is. I come from a premise that the Word of God is true. And God has given us this. And we have to come to a faith base to accept the truth of God's Word, and it can be applicable to life in situations that we face. It gives us the purpose for our living. It gives us guidelines for lifestyles. It allows us to hear God speak to us through His Spirit as we read His Word, as we meditate on His Word. We have recently finished a project that this church has done through the summer. As long as guests, they've had Vacation Bible School. We have celebrated 101 years. And looking back at the records, I don't know of any time we've ever missed Vacation Bible School at First Baptist Church, except during the summer of 20 when it was virtual, but we still had it. And we teach children the Bible, Vacation Bible School. We teach children the Bible, and they are taught to memorize the Bible. And I'll assure you, 20 years from now, they will remember going to Vacation Bible School and remember what they learned. The reason why I know that, because I still do. I still remember vividly sitting in the church education wing, as we call it, a Sunday school class, a Bible school class, and we were taught the Bible. We teach that every Sunday at our church. People bring their Bibles and open them up, and we read from the Scriptures. We are taught from a teacher who has studied throughout the week, and we make preparation to teach the truths of God's Word. When John said these words, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." That's another kind of freedom that Jesus gives, a freedom far. He sets us free for life, to be able to use our unique abilities and skills and talents for His service, for literally holiness, living a life that has standards and principles, and for love. The freedom Christ gives us is freedom from some things and freedom for some things. Paul includes both concepts in the passage that we have read this morning in Galatians, the 5th chapter, in verse 1. "For it is freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then." And if he gives us any kind of a instruction in this particular passage, it's to stand firm. Stand at what we would call attention. Stand ready for battle. Stand ready to engage. During the Olympics that I enjoy watching so much and seeing gifted athletes compete in the field of what is known as friendly competition. When they run a race, they're in their blocks or they're standing on the line. Their hearts are racing. Their body is set. They have stand firm. The idea of the word picture is ready for that kind of competition to move forward as soon as they hear ready, set, mark, and a gun is fired, and they're off in the race that they run. Do not let yourselves be burdened again. And oftentimes you and I carry so many burdens in our lifetime, by the yoke of slavery that it enslaves us. So we're constantly looking for that kind of promise, even this day. Paul places the word freedom at the beginning of the sentence to emphasize it. Literally, the verse says, freedom is what Christ has set us free for. See, we are made to be set free. When we look at the history of the Bible, you will find that people who have been given freedom found bondage because of their sin, and God has all through the ages prepared for us the coming of Messiah, who would shed his blood at Calvary's cross as a payment for sin to allow us to be set free, to live a life have with purpose and meaning and literally joy again in our lives. We've been set free for both the freedom from and the freedom for. We are made for freedom. Paul tells us freedom is why Jesus came and literally died on a cross and rose from the dead. It is freedom that Christ has set us free. Let me share some things of people that I've had a great deal even of respect for in my lifetime. One is Zig Ziglar. Now, Zig Ziglar was a great communicator, as oftentimes called. He's a storyteller. Let me tell you where his career began. He started selling pots and pans door to door. That's where his career began. And he was a lifelong salesman. He was an amazing man in his ability to communicate. Yes, he was a Sunday school teacher after he found Christ and became an amazing teacher of the Bible. He gave his testimony about the Christian life. And when he started sharing his testimony, it has become widely circulated in many of the books that he has written. And one I recommend to every parent, How to Raise Positive Kids in a Negative World. I've alluded to some of the stories over the years in sermons that I've preached. There is a Raising Positive Kids in a Negative World revised because some of the terminology is updated, and even the times of which we now live, children grow up different than they did when maybe I was a child or maybe when you were raising your children. You realize that everybody under the age of 18, those who just finished high school last year, seems like months ago, and it was months ago, but we celebrated high school graduation in the summer, school starting again. That age group of kids who just finished high school are known as digitals because they grew up with a digital phone in their hand. I can remember making my first cell phone call on a cell phone that almost had to have a suitcase to carry it. And kids now have phones, and teachers have to deal with that, but they're called digital. So it's been an upgraded book. So it's still a great book because it oftentimes changes the person who's reading the book more than it does kids. And Zig Ziglar was telling his testimony. It's included in many of the books he's written. He said, I confess there are some things I've given up since I've accepted Christ. He said, I've given up staying awake at night, worrying about things I can't change. He said, God knows some of the things, and he knows the thing. He knows all. He's the one staying up all night. Why do I need to stay up? Be worried about things that God is going to take care of. He's going to be up, so I need to quit worrying. And I have to tell myself that oftentimes when I get concerned and worried about things. He's given up worrying about his finances because he knows God knows his needs. He's expressed his needs to God. And in that process, he's concerned with my well-being. And I know that he's going to provide and bless and always have. He also enjoys the freedom that he has in Christ. Freedom from some things that used to enslave him, bother him, and keep him captive in his thoughts and allows him to dream. That was the words from one of the great communicators and salesmen of a generation. Many of you probably know this man. His name is Billy Graham. You've heard of him. He offers another story. He was 86 years of age when he preached what was known as his last crusade. Billy Graham is a crusade evangelist, and he has spent his life, now he's in heaven, but he spent his life just simply helping people understand who Jesus is and how to accept him into their lives. When he was preaching his last crusade, it was technically in 2009 at the site of two World's Fairs in New York City, Flushing Meadows, Carnot Park, in down close to the downtown area in New York City. He was racked by many physical ailments. He preached to a packed house. Many estimated that it was 90,000 people there to hear him preach, maybe one of his last sermons. He preached the gospel from the very beginning of his crusade evangelism in 1949 in what is known as Greater LA today. He spoke in front of more than 2 million people in his lifetime. He enjoyed the freedom in Christ, a freedom far some things. He had the freedom to proclaim what he believed, what he knew, and what he found to be true in his lifetime. Do not get caught up in these two examples, for you miss one of the most amazing messages in Galatians, the 5th chapter and verse 1. Paul claims that we are made for freedom. Freedom is why Jesus came and died on the cross and rose again on the third day, known as the resurrection. We're made to be free, free from the bondage of our sin, from the power of Satan, from the burden of our guilt. We've been set free even today, whatever may be troubling us in our spirit. So we're constantly looking for that reality moment. We observe Christians today, we look at their own lives. They're confronted by perplexity. Many Christians know they know they're to be free, but they don't know how to be free. Or they've not really experienced it. Maybe dealing with everyday situations, how to be free because the Spirit of God lives within us. Some people have taken their freedoms maybe to the extent of inviolating other people's freedoms. See, we have people who take their freedom, and because of their freedoms, they feel like they can force freedom on someone else. Oftentimes, we find ourselves in straitjackets or causing other people to live in straitjackets. Early in this service today, there was a mention of a minister's retreat this last few days in the city of Albuquerque, sponsored by the Baptist Convention of New Mexico. And one of the preachers who once served in our state, Charles Lowry, who referred to as Nathan's childhood pastor, was the guest speaker for the event. Over the years, I've had the privilege of hearing him deliver many messages and listen to things now on podcast and can watch many of the things that he does, read books that he has written. A very gifted communicator. And he is very gifted at telling a story to make a point. I remember hearing one of those stories and reading about it, about Charles Lowry and four monkeys placed in a room. I don't know if you've ever heard this, but there's four monkeys in a room. And might be a zoo, could be somebody had monkeys as a pet, I don't know, but let's just say it's in a zoo, and they have an enclosure, and they put a pole in the middle of this monkey house with four monkeys. And at the top, they've placed some bananas. And the monkeys discovered there's bananas up there, so one of the monkeys starts going up. And about when he's reaching for the banana, he gets blasted by freezing cold water. And so he does not capture a banana. He just goes down the pole, but all four monkeys go up. And same event takes place. Every time they go up, they get blasted by freezing cold water. After a while, the monkeys don't even go up the pole anymore. So they take one of the monkeys out and put in a new monkey. The monkey starts to go up the pole, but the other monkeys pull him back down. And then they start putting in another monkey and another monkey. But soon they realize that the pole is off limits. Nobody goes up the pole to capture a banana, even after they take the nozzle away that blasts the cold water at the monkey. It often happens in the life of Christians, even in the church. We have been within reach of a delicious offering of spiritual fruit. We've come to sing songs of praise. We hear the prayers offered corporately. Oftentimes, we come to church and we begin to hear the message, and somehow or another, and you've never done this, maybe I'm the one that needs help, but sometimes our mind wanders. We're in some other place. We're thinking about something else. I mean, one of the most spiritual things you could do to come to church is to rest as well as pray. Sometimes we are praying about the circumstances that we are faced with, or what's going on in our lives, or where we'd like to be, or what we'd like to do. Sometimes we get caught up in the monkey stories. I mean, who in the world would put four monkeys in a room with a cold water blaster at them? What was the purpose of this? Maybe it's to help us all to understand a concept. Leonard Sweet, a scholar and writer and preacher and theologian, made a statement: our lives get chloroformed by the chlorophyll of convention. Sometimes we have assembled and we get to the place that we don't even feel that we have the right to be free. It'd be like somebody who may have an addiction. Now, we're going to leave alcohol and drugs out of that. We have an addiction to sweets. Or sometimes we get addicted to crippling things that destroy our mental well-being, like pornography. Or we get caught up in activities like gambling that can devastate us financially. And we're in a bondage and we don't know how to get free of this. And yet God keeps speaking to us that we have been set free. The fear of the unknown holds us back, prevents us from experiencing freedom. Being a prisoner provides us a certain amount of security. No risk of sabotage or freedom is putting us into roadblocks in a way. And oftentimes there are roadblocks that have destroyed us, oftentimes for a lifetime. In the setting, I came to grips that as Charles Lowry, a pastor who's even preaching in a Baptist church even this morning, was saying how different he and his wife were when they married, how they grew up different. He grew up in rural Alabama. And she grew up quite refined in a home of wealth. And they had a lot of things to work through in a marriage situation. We have different people who have come to church expecting different things. When they come to church, some people think they're worries are going to be over and the financial situation is going to be changed immediately when they walk out the door. And we often find that it may not be. And I'll assure you that God can deliver manna from heaven because we know that it is, but he's not going to just drop money in your lap. He has, at times, given us an opportunity. I think that opportunity happens every day when we wake up in the morning and we walk out the door and we have a place of employment. God has given us an opportunity to earn and to make and to provide for our families. But it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. That is what Paul affirms in this passage that we've read in verse 1. Yet over and over again, the very thing Paul warns us against is that we get burdened again by the yoke of slavery. So we're looking for the solution. What is the answer? And Jesus reveals that to us in John, the 8th chapter, verse 31. If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. In John, the 8th chapter, in verse 31 and 32. You and I have been set free by this concept that we have grasped for even today. There are many of us, and I have been one who have been watching the Olympics, and I'd like to show you a photo of an Olympic participant, actually a gold medal winner. This photo, and I want you to look at it for a while, is the photo of Sydney McLaughlin. 19 years old, gold medal winner. There'll be no other sports figure that will get so much attention in Christianity since Eric Little, who ran for Scotland, and a movie was made, Chariots of Fire, about him. He would not run on Sunday because that was a day of worship, and they changed his race from 100 meters to 400 meters, and Eric Little still won a gold medal. Sydney McLaughlin said this in Sports Spectrum, a Christian news organization that reports Christianity in sports. What I have in Christ is far greater than gold. She set a world record in her 400 hurdles at the Olympic Games in Tokyo recently, which concludes today. She also ran the 4x4 relay, the first leg, and the Olympic team of the 4x4 set a blistering time of 3.16.85, less than a half a second off the world record. She stayed quiet all during the Olympics until she won the 400-meter hurdles. Let me start off by saying what an honor is to be able to represent not only my country, but also the kingdom of God. What I have in Christ is far greater than what I have or don't have in life. He, God, has prepared me for the moment such as this, that I may use these gifts that he has given me to point all attention back to him. She has been set free from, to be set free for. She knows what her ability is, and she knows how she is to use it. For you see, freedom comes from the discipline of years of daily training. You don't get to the point of a Hall of Fame run or to be able to hold up a gold medal unless you take the time and the discipline of practice and preparing. Ask any actor. They perform because they have been set free, because they're ready to perform. Ask a musician who spends many hours at a piano, maybe a concert pianist, that we would spend a great deal of energy, time, and effort and money to go to listen to them play. They are set free because they have learned the skill of their ability to be able to perform. But what is the allegiance to? Some do it for themselves and their self-glory. But a Christian does it to give glory to God Almighty, for He is the one who has set us free. Freedom in Christ will come in the same way as a result of a disciplined daily life and a submission to the Lord Jesus. We submit our time to God. Too often, everything else seems to be important instead of the relationship that we have with God. I find myself, I've got to get outside and hurry this morning while it's still cool to water my flowers and my vegetables, when really I just need to relax and be free in a relationship with God, in a time what is known, we often call it a quiet time, or a time to just meditate and pray. We need to remember the biblical promise that freedom is what we have been made for, and we're all made to enjoy the freedom from the bondage of sin. Now, please understand, there's two schools in Texas. One is Sunday school and Texas A&M, but I want to show you a tower photo of the University of Texas in Austin. Now, many people don't know what is at the University of Texas at Austin, but at the very top of that tower, where you see the clock and you see at the top, there is a statement from the King James Version of the Scriptures. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Another photo of that, I think there's another one available. You'll notice that that tower has stood from the existence of the University of Texas, day and night, stating to its students that you are to be in search of truth. The key to experiencing that freedom is if you hold to my teaching, if you're really my disciples, if you seek God's truth and believe it in your heart and accept it into your life, you will be set free and be free to pursue the things of life that are so vitally important to you. To be able to properly love God and love your family. To be able to pursue a career that adds to meaning to your life. Too often, we have missed some things. Like in my father's generation, you were known as a carpenter. And sometimes we get caught up in what we do. You know, I'm an electrician, or I'm a lawyer, or I'm a preacher, or I lead music, and we're identified with that. And our whole world functions around those things. But we need to transition our thoughts. I am a Christian. I am a follower of Christ. I have become a disciple of Jesus. He has redeemed me from the burden I've carried because of my sin. And we know we're sinners. But what we really need to have experiencing being able to set free from that experience and the burden that we carry. It only comes by acknowledging Him as our God, surrendering our life, giving it to Him, and allowing Him to transform us from the inside out. You will know the truth. That truth speaks to our heart and it speaks to every generation, and through the daily discipline of our lives to the teaching of Christ, we can experience the blessed promise, which is so wonderful as a passage that we've read today. It is for freedom Christ has set you free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourself be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. Today, I just simply ask that you may want to bow your head. And what is it that has burdened you? Is it not really knowing who God is? I'll never forget the words of a person who shared, I can surrender. I will surrender my life today to God. And I freely give you my life today, Lord. Forgive me my sin. Come into my life. I accept you as my Savior and Lord today. Thank you for saving my soul. At the end of this message, we'll be having a song that'll be led by Brooke and Nathan. And I'm going to be standing in front. I'm going to invite you to come forward and say, Preacher, I've accepted Christ. I've done this in my lifetime, but I've really never given testimony of my faith in Christ as a believer by being baptized as what is known a believer's baptism. Baptism comes after salvation, not before. And so you may be a grown adult that needs to give testimony of the fact, as many have had in this church over the years, that I'm a follower of Christ, and I'm not ashamed to give a testimony of baptism. You may need to move your membership to this church. Or you may just need to repent of sin and say, I've neglected some things in my spiritual discipline. God, I just ask you to bless the people assembled here. Whatever decision needs to be made, we trust that you're moving in all of our lives. Nathan leads us. As I make my way to this front of this altar, you need to make a decision. Will you do that this day?
Would you share that with someone this week, the truth that you have heard this morning, the truth that you carry inside you? Would you share that with someone? There's a lot of people that need to hear that wonderful, glorious good news of the gospel. 505-722-4401 is our phone number, fbcgallup.com, firstbaptistgallup@gmail.com. If you need prayer, if you want to share with something with us this week, whatever it is you might need or be going through, we want you to give us a call or to email us and let us know so that we can help you. We are all in this together. We are one body together. And thank goodness the Lord made it to where we would not be alone, but together. Amen. Before I turn it back over to Pastor Jay, that's really all the announcements we have today, but over the past few weeks, if you could be in prayer for Amber Fry, she's been working a lot, but she's also been ill. And so if you could be in prayer for her, we're hoping she's going to be back helping us. But there has been a guy who is always coming in here positive, always working hard, And he has been here to pick up the slack. And even a couple Sundays ago, he was doing everything back there by himself. And I want to acknowledge Curtis Oglesby, who just hid himself behind there, and thank him for how hard he's been working. So if you wouldn't mind, as you leave the service today, to go back there and say thank you to Curtis. And also my wife, if you could pray for her. She has had a hurt shoulder for the past few weeks. She's got it in a sling, but she also was very kind and gracious to come and help us with the slides this morning. So if you could go back there and just thank both of those guys. That is the unsung heroes of what we do in the service. If it weren't for those guys, we couldn't get things on the radio. We couldn't get things on social media. So thank those guys, and I'll turn it back over to Pastor Jay.
Thank you, Nathan. Thank you, guys, for helping us with worship. As we part in peace, may the grace of God be upon your lives. Please place your offering in the basket on your way out. Steve Thomas, will you dismiss us?